Chris? Thank you, Brother Cooper. I am Chris Cuomo. Welcome to Primetime. So, what do you do when your biggest adversary attacks your election? President Trump is inviting him home for the holidays. Yes, Trump says a second sit-down is coming, and soon. It sounds like a movie, like a drama that plays like a comedy until it is revealed to be a horror flick. Welcome to Washington, Comrade Vlad. Let's get some perspective. Tom has met with the President before. He knows exactly what is at stake. And the former National Security Advisor will pass along his wisdom to you tonight. So, you know who was stunned by the news of the invite? The head of U.S. intelligence, Dan Coats. He didn't know about it. He was informed on the stage by a journalist. You will not want to miss his reaction. And with all the concerns raised by the red menace that is Russia, Trump had the audacity, the unmitigated gall, to say the real enemy to America is a free press. Attacking a signature American freedom? Not on our watch. What do you say? Let's get after it. All right, so President Trump in the White House once again walking back something he said in the aftermath of Helsinki, the third reversal this week. Now he finally agrees that handing over American diplomats to Russia is a bad idea. And apparently the summit went so well, the White House is planning round two, even if nobody told the Director of National Intelligence. This is where we are tonight. Joining us to talk about this, former National Security Advisor to President Obama, Tom Donilon. Welcome to Primetime, sir.
Chris, thanks for having me on. Nice to see you.
All right, so let's back up a little bit.
Yeah.
Helsinki.
Yeah.
Trump comes out of a meeting. It was one-on-one. Nobody else was in there but the translator. He stands next to Vladimir Putin and says, Coates says Russia did it. I don't know why they would. Putin was really strong in his denial. That's good enough for me. And I think both sides did lots of things wrong. Your reaction?
Well, a couple of things. First of all, it was the first time that I know of in the history of the United States where a United States president stood next to an adversary took the side of the adversary against the unanimous view of his intelligence services and his law enforcement services. He did this, by the way, as you know, on the Monday after the Friday that our law enforcement services indicted 12 Russian military intelligence agents for hacking, attacking the United States election in 2016.
An indictment also, that he was okay having come out. We now know that Rosenstein went to him right before Helsinki and said, we have this. Do you want me to hold it? He said no. Why would he say no and then do what he did in Helsinki?
Well, it's, you know, as a lot of this policy with respect to Russia is, it's inexplicable. But what you have here, though, Chris, I think is quite important from a structural and really deep perspective, which is a real disconnect between the United States president and his intelligence services and his law enforcement services, and a disconnect on a fundamental matter as to what happened in 2016, and more broadly, as to who the Russians are and what they're up to. You know, this is much more than about the elections in 2016. That's really important, and we can talk about what to do about that. An attack on our democracy. And by the way, we use this phrase meddling. I wouldn't use that.
We begin with yet another surprise. President Trump has invited.
That's exactly. I think that's much closer and more precise as to what happened in 2016.
So here's Trump's theory of the case. I'm being good to Russia because it is good for America, because we need Russia to help with all of our main security concerns. The Obama administration did not get that. Here is him expressing the sentiment, making the case to CNBC today.
Look at all of the things that I've done. Nobody else did what I've done. Obama didn't do it. Obama was a patsy for Russia. He was a total patsy.
He says, I've been tougher, I've done more, and I know I need them, and I can get Putin to help me with nukes in Syria, to hold down ISIS, to tame Iran, and to help with North Korea. And that's why I'm treating him the way I am. Do you accept the argument?
I think all laudable goals. I think it misrepresents the Obama administration approach. There was no denial of Russian adverse and hostile activities to the United States. President Obama didn't deny that, in fact, the Russians were trying to hack the election and took a number of steps during the course of the campaign and afterwards. But what it also does is, I think it underscores and underestimates that you have to go at this from a position of strength, Chris. And it also misses the fact, and it doesn't understand, I don't think, just how broad base the hostile activities by Russia are against the West and the United States. It's not just the elections that I was saying earlier. It's Crimea, the taking over of territory for the first time since World War II. It's Ukraine, where 10,000 people have been killed. Right. It's siding with the Taliban in Afghanistan and attacking our forces. It's aiding and abetting war crimes in Syria.
And,
it's
nerve attacks. In the UK, by the way.
In the UK.
And in the UK with Skirpal. You know, just today they identified that they believe from videotape the two suspects they have left the UK to return to Russia.
Yes.
Small coincidence there. Those are their two suspects. But Trump says that's all on you, Donlan. All that happened on your watch.
Well,
and you can't expect him to own that. He's looking to make a better tomorrow.
Yeah, he's the president of the United States, and you need to deal with this from a position of strength. And giving, and what happened, I think, in Helsinki, Chris, and again, kind of a bottom line analysis here, is that Putin sought and received a concept that you and I would understand, absolution without any penance, without any cost, which was what he sought. And it's kind of extraordinary that we would do that. And we did that, by the way. And so many things happened during the course of this week that we missed some things, right, or forget some things. He went to Helsinki after going through Europe and relentlessly leaning into and attacking our allies. And then the contrast of embracing Putin is really stunning. For us to succeed with Russia, and in fact, it is in our interest ultimately to have a set of relationships among great powers, we're going to have to do it from a position of strength. And giving Putin absolution with respect to this conduct and this actively hostile conduct against the United States and the West is not going to get us where we want to go. The other thing that's really important to keep in mind here is the undermining of the West by Putin more generally, the undermining of Western institutions, NATO and the European Union, and the president playing a part in that, either willingly or unwillingly, the president really aiding and abetting what have been longtime Russian strategic goals and before that Soviet strategic goals to separate the United States from Europe, to sow discontent in Europe, and to undermine the confidence of democracies. That's the long game that's underway here, so, and one that we have to resist, and will only be resisted with leadership from the United States. I'm sorry to interrupt you.
No, interrupt. The interview is all about you. I don't know anything. I'm asking the questions of somebody who has lived this job and who's dealt with Putin. So if we are to believe that there is a strategy at play here, and that they are playing, as you use the term, long ball in America's interests, how do you explain the piece of sound that I'm about to play right now with Dan Coats at the Aspen Forum with Andrea Mitchell today? Listen to this.
We have some breaking news. The White House has announced on Twitter that Vladimir Putin is coming to the White House in the fall.
Say that again?
Vladimir Putin coming
to the... Did I hear you?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
That's going to be special.
Holy smokes. Yeah. I mean, unless he's a great actor and doing a little Dana Carvey bit there as the church lady, that'll be special. Dan Coats, the director of national intelligence, didn't know that they were going to invite Putin to the United States? Yeah. Is that possible?
Well, it's evidently possible because it happened today. But again, I tried exceedingly hard not to be partisan about these things because my devotion is to U.S. security in a nonpartisan way. But these are some observations, I think. Number one, the disconnect we talked about at the beginning between the president and his team. Number two, really poor coordination here and process. It doesn't look like there was any process underway in which at least the head of national intelligence participated in.
No, this is Trump saying, you think I did the wrong thing with Putin? Yeah. I'll double down. Yeah. That's what he's doing. You just think he would tell his guys.
Yeah, and you can have terrible outcomes from a lack of process. Dwight Eisenhower once said, the good process won't guarantee you a good outcome, but bad process almost always will ensure that you make a mistake. And so the job of the National Security Advisor is to ensure this doesn't happen. The job of the National Security Advisor is to ensure that the team is acting in coordination with the president.
Well, what can
they do? And that the country presents to the world a coherent story.
Well, what do you do, Tom? I mean, if you go to the president and he's like, I got it. I didn't tell you. Yeah, what are you going to do about it? What does he do? He doesn't want to resign because he thinks that the president needs him. He needs calm heads. He needs people who know the job. But he's getting kind of, you know, thrown under the bus, which is a little bit of a common experience these days.
It's a severe breakdown, and it really does damage the United States, I think. And you end up with things like Helsinki. The Helsinki summit should not have happened. It wasn't well prepared. We didn't really have a set of goals. Most importantly, we didn't really work with our allies in kind of getting agreement on the goals. And we certainly should have looked very closely at canceling it after the indictments last Friday came out, showing the and I would encourage your viewers, if they get the opportunity, because you really understand just how incredible our intelligence and law enforcement services are. Look at that indictment from last Friday. Mm-hmm. Yeah, look at the precision with which
horror show, President Trump should have reversed course, but he sees that as weakness. So instead, he's doubling down and inviting Putin back to his house, literally bringing him to Washington, D.C. this fall. This is like a bad movie. When he told his family his new boyfriend was the town creep who broke into their house, he responded to their outrage by inviting Vlad home for the holidays. That's what's going on. This is the Sarah Sanders tweet. Take a look at it. Those discussions are already underway. The director of national intelligence hadn't even been told about this. This is the mom, he already bought his ticket part of this melodrama movie. So what are they going to do when they're here? That's the plot. And Trump says, well, he's changed. Putin wants to help on terrorism. He wants to help secure Israel, end nuclear proliferation, stop cyber attacks, Middle East peace, North Korea. And even something about Ukraine. It's all in the tweets, but vague. But there's also conflict here, right? Because there's nothing that's going to be on the table that Russia doesn't like about its malevolence around the world. Stopping cyber attacks? You're going to be partners with the person who victimized you. No Ukraine? No mass murder in Ukraine with MH17? I will never forget how I saw Russian separatists treat the dead there. Nothing about Syrian violence against innocents? How about what Trump is ignoring this week? That's going to be the subplot in this movie, that Trump is blind to the signs. Just this week, accused Russian spy, working the NRA, different righty groups, allegedly trying to get close to Trump by exchanging sex for access. And today, British authorities identified the suspects in the UK poisoning case. And guess what they saw via surveillance footage? They say the two suspects left the UK for Russia after the poisoning. Coincidence? Maybe to Trump. Not the time to invite Putin into our house. And there's just one chance that can make this all okay. The climax, as Trump sees it, is that everything that he's doing, all the kid gloves, the molly coddling and everything else, is to work with Putin to save the world from nuclear proliferation. Now, if that's the trade-off for all of this curious weakness and submissiveness to an autocrat, that might be okay. But there are two pieces of video that make a mushroom cloud of that mission at this point. The first was when Putin sent missiles to Florida. You remember that? In the Chris Wallace interview, he says, well, it doesn't say Florida on it. We don't know. It's a landmass, looks just like Florida. He was punking Trump, and it worked. Trump said nothing about it. And then, just this week, they want to talk about strategic limitation of arms? Well, then why did they do this? Why did they show some of their munitions that should be stopped under those kinds of talks? So the only way that this is okay is if Trump makes it an open house. There have to be tons of voices in the room. Sounds reasonable, but here's the problem. To Trump, it's going to sound weak again. He wants to be the big man in the room, the same way he felt in Helsinki. So there you have it. The plot, the conflict, the subplot, the climax, the anticlimax. The only question is, how does it end? We will see. We do know this. Putin is still up to no good. And now it looks like he's coming to your home for the holidays. Will Trump really be his worst enemy if it doesn't work out? Do either of these two believe that? That is the making of a great debate. Those smiles, let's see if they stay. Got Nina Turner and Jason Miller for a great debate. It's good to see you all. We're going to start off with the main arguments that each of you have to take on. Nina, we'll start with you. Trump's main argument is this. Obama was weak and got Russia to help on nothing. ISIS got worse. The Middle East got worse. Nukes got worse. Russia is the key. That's why I'm being nice to him, because we need him to fix everything. And that's why I'm inviting him home for the holidays.
To the people's house, Chris. You know, it just doesn't make sense. I mean, this president has never followed the lead of President Obama before, and it's just quite telling that he wants to blame everything on President Obama. President Donald J. Trump, newsflash, is the president right now, and he has an obligation to protect this country and to stand up to President Putin. Talking to your adversary is one thing, but being totally rolled by your adversary is another thing. And insulting the intelligence community on foreign soil is not cute, is not nice. And the president absolutely went a bridge too far, or in the words of my grandmother, he wrote a check that his behind could not cash, even though she would have said the other word, Chris. And it's just
asset.
Funny that the president could be assets, yes. It's funny that he can be tough when it comes to women leaders. Right here, our national leaders, like Congresswoman, like Senator Elizabeth Warren, or Congresswoman Maxine Waters, he always got smack to talk, or to our international leaders like Merkel or May. But when he stood next to President Putin, he melted like butter.
Well,
so
whatever it was,
has a problem.
Whether it was gender, whatever it was, Jason, it looked bad, and it led to this moment on the floor of Congress today.
We have sworn an oath to defend our Constitution and our liberty.
The gentleman's time has expired.
Against all enemies, foreign and domestic.
The gentleman's time has expired.
You have the opportunity to do that today.
The Democrats chanting USA. Very interesting, Jason Miller, if not telling. They all take an oath to protect America against enemies, foreign and domestic. The president does not. He takes an oath to the Constitution and uphold its laws. However, be that as it may, how weak a position is Trump in right now after Helsinki?
I think he's in a good position right now, and I think today's move to go and invite Putin.
When you say good, how do you mean that word?
Well, I think good in the fact that now that the president has gotten together with Vladimir Putin and they've started to develop that relationship frequently in these meetings, at least the first one, you're not going to get a heck of a lot done. You're going to kind of feel out the other person, talk a little bit about the issues. But as we look at the
adopt
broader
all his
global,
own positions and
but,
throw your on, own intel but, people hold, under but, the bus, you can't leave that
Chris,
part out.
Hold on. But as we look at the global chessboard, whether we're talking Lebanon, whether we're talking Syria, whether we're talking Iran, whether we're talking Ukraine, whether we're talking North Korea,
right.
Russia is a critical player
True.
In all of these places.
True.
And we have to have their buy-in. And in fact, these things are getting so crisscrossed up. I mean, the fact of the matter is that Hezbollah right now
right.
is using arms that they got from Assad, that they got from Russia.
True.
And so, of course, Russia is going to be a major player.
So
in this.
How
so
does when Trump forgiving them for their malevolence make it more likely that they will help you?
I don't think he forgave him for their
he adopted his position on Russian interference and betrayed his own intelligence
community.
No, but
Chris, but prior to the press conference, and I do think that the president could have been stronger in the press conference because he's come out and he has criticized Russia. He said that Russia was behind the meddling a number of times before. He's absolutely said that. When Putin came out, he even said that Trump was challenging him on a number of these fronts that I discussed just a moment ago. And so you need that first meeting to kind of feel each other out, kind of see what the situation is. And then it's that second meeting where I think we're really going to get down to the details. And that's where Trump can get it accomplished.
So that's
now, and I think that's part of the reason they
right,
got out in front of it. And they said the invite is there. Let's
right.
make Putin come here. Let's press him. Now, here's the one word of caution that I would say, Chris,
yeah.
is that for a second meeting, the second meeting is where we need to know that we have real results, that we know that we've gone beyond the talk from Putin. Because as we saw, I know this from working for the president for 7 months and even said this today in his CNBC interview, where he'll go with the trust factor, but if he gets double-crossed or if he doesn't think he's getting a good deal, he'll become someone's worst enemy, and
I know,
he won't
said
have
that
a problem
today.
To do that.
Look,
he
did,
and that's,
the,
but working for him, I've seen that before. But just the final, just final quick thing is that it's critical in a second meeting that we do get the concrete
I know, but Jason,
results
look,
on
of
this.
Of course you're going to set all these expectations for the second meeting. You blew the first one. You know, they want a second bite at the apple.
Chris.
You think they should get one?
I mean, that's part of the problem is it is about whether the president thinks he's getting a good deal What about the American people? He keeps linking this Russia situation with his legitimacy as being the president of the United States of America. He just can't get over that. And that's one of the reasons why he will not go hard or ham, as the millennials would say it, on President Putin. He cannot allow, and to know that they did this, to let the President Putin off in this way. Again, having conversations, I don't disagree with Jason in terms of, yes, should we have a conversation with our adversaries? Absolutely. But should we let our adversaries take advantage of us? Absolutely not. And that is what the president displayed. And that is what got the 98 senators to vote to say that, Mr. President, how dare you agree at the time that he was there that it would be a good idea to allow the Russian government to interrogate American citizens? What U.S. president does that? This president does it because he only looks out for himself and his image, and he doesn't care about what happens to this country in totality. It's about his ego.
It's the second time he brought the Senate together. Left and right, right? You got a lot of ice locking those two apart.
Both times it's been over Russia, Jason.
I hope we can bring them together on some other issues too, Chris.
Okay, well, let's talk about the specifics here.
When the president shut down these Russian consulates, was he being weak? When he kicked out these businesses and these business leaders?
A lot of that was extending what the Obama administration had put in place.
When he said he's going to send additional arms and energy to Ukraine, when he talked about creating more of a divide between Germany and Russia on pipelines.
There are odd conditions on how those arms can be used in Ukraine.
So you're saying he shouldn't have done that?
I'm saying what he shouldn't have done was thrown his country under the bus in Helsinki. I watched it. It was embarrassing as an American.
Respectfully speaking, Chris, you're talking out of both sides of your mouth.
How so?
Because you're saying the president's not being tough, and then I talk about very specific actions that he's taking.
And I qualified each of them as not really that tough. One is extending Obama and his administration. He gave arms to Ukraine, but they can't really use them against the Russians.
Intelligence and military leaders have been on this channel and other channels this entire week saying, well, yeah, actually Trump has done quite a bit with regard to Russia. I mean, that is almost across the board.
Not on my show they have it. That's not what I've been hearing. I'll tell you something else. And then, Nina, I'm going to bounce it to you. You say they have a plan. You say there's a reason they want the second meeting, that it's this two-phase effect. How come Dan Coats doesn't know about it?
Well, okay, this is on Dan Coats. This is on Dan Coats. And
this is on him?
Yeah, this is absolutely on Dan Coats.
So the president announces he's bringing Gladhorn for the holidays, and you know who?
Pompeo knew about it. Bolton knew about it. If Dan Coats didn't know about it, that is on him. First of all,
what is he doing out in Aspen?
What is he doing out in Aspen at this conference with a bunch of Trump haters? I don't understand that at all. Here's the fact: is when you work for the president and you're going under the bus.
I'm saying when you work for the president.
And you're doing a big interview or you're doing some event, you know to go and check in with the president about what's going on. If Dan Coats hasn't gone and checked in with the president at this point, that's on him. I mean, what, did they change the White House phone number this week, Chris? Did they change the phone number and he lost it?
Is it on Dan Coats, Nina?
This is not the first time that he didn't know what the president was up to, Jason.
Obviously, the president has discussed this with the rest of his team, and they're dialed
in. The president should have discussed it with his director of intelligence. He discussed it with Bolton, with Pompeo. How do you know that, Jason?
How do you know that? These guys have been talking to me all week telling me they didn't know it was going to happen in Helsinki. They were blindsided. They don't know why he said it. They've been trying to get him to correct it. You got poor Bill Shine, his first week on the job, trying to figure out how to correct message on that. And now you're saying it's all part of a concerted plan that Dan Coats is wrong not to know about? Now you want to say
Dan Coats is in charge of everything?
He's the director of national intelligence. The president's obviously
much closer with Bolton and Pompeo, and I'm absolutely confident that they're dialed in and everything going on here. And I think the president has a good plan. It's good to go and do it this week while everybody on the political left is completely triggered and whipped up on this thing.
Yeah, that's what happens when you betray your country on the world stage.
Listen, you made the point you needed to make,
but I got to tell you, Nina, he gave me the vapors when he started talking about having a plan that nobody knows about. All right. Thanks both for making the case. Nina Turner, you win. All right. So in Trump world, Russia is our friend. I'll tell you who the real enemy is. Us. Really? An American signature freedom is what the president wants to identify as the true enemy of the masses. I got to tell you, just when you thought you couldn't be more embarrassed, Mao said it, Stalin said it, and now Trump says it, calling a free press the enemy of the people. You think Anthony Scaramucci will say it and then get knocked out? He's up on deck and hopefully not about to get decked next on Cuomo Primetime. Good to see you, Anthony. When media criticizes the president, people say, if they're sympathetic to the president, we have Trump derangement syndrome. But back here in reality, it's derangement when the president of the United States says that Putin is the enemy? No. This is what's happened here. Thoughts straight in reality. The president says Putin is not the enemy. A free press is the enemy. That kind of statement makes the Manchurian candidate seem like Citizen Kane. And it raises the concern of what is going on in his head. Anthony Scaramucci says he knows, and he's here with us on Prime Time.
I don't know if I said I know.
You said I know. I'll tell you what this is about.
I'm doing the best I can here.
Why would he call a signature American freedom the enemy of the people, and Putin is not?
So he means surgically and selectively. He thinks he's been treated badly by certain members of the press. I don't like the rhetoric at all. Okay, I don't like the war declaration on the media. I don't like the calling out of individual journalists. I don't like the specific tweet attacks on the journalists. It's just not for me. Okay, and I would tell him that directly. I was only there for 11 days. I said it 3 or 4 times. You know, at the end of the day, it doesn't help him. Okay, he's a television star. I like the fact that he's out on these other networks. Hopefully, he'll come on your show or shows here on CNN at some point. He has to have the opportunity to have a free and fair hearing, and he has to knock off the attacks on the press because it's not helping him.
He believes it is helping him, and in fact, they're going in the other direction. They're not going in the direction you're saying they should move. They only go on the mothership at Fox. They don't let people out. Pompeo's coming out tonight. He's only going to talk to Fox tonight.
No, but he went on CNBC. He went on CBS.
He does.
He's trying. The president is trying to expand his television broadcast.
Or do you think they're just one-offs to justify the fact that he's been on Fox 50 times as often?
No, I don't. Listen, I think Bill Shine is in place, and I think Bill Shine is a very logical, smart, thoughtful guy. And he's giving him honest advice.
Tough first week for him to start his job.
Yeah, listen, he's a tough guy. He helped build that network over there from scratch, and he knows what he's doing. He's a very competent person. But here's the thing, okay? The best people, you know this, and I know this, okay? If an employee of mine walks in and tells me that I am tall and right, I know I'm going to have a problem with the employee. If they tell me I'm short and wrong, now I know I've got a relationship with the employee, that they're going to be speaking truthfully to me. And they're going to tell me what's going on in the business to make the business better.
He doesn't have that around him.
Well, he's got to get that around him. Okay, I think Pompeo's like that. I think Bolton's like that. I think Bill Shine is like that. He's got to get those people.
Then how did Helsinki happen?
I think Kellyanne is like that, by the way. And now the problem is I made the biggest mistake. I mentioned 4 people that I like, and so that'll probably hurt those 4 people, the people that don't like me. But it doesn't
not
really,
here. I just want to get your sense of what's going on.
No, but it matters because we're on air.
But if they have people around him who speak truth to power and tell him what to do, how did Helsinki happen?
A lack of preparation was one of the big issues there. And you're going to be sore at me for saying the following thing. You have to sort of work around the president and the president's personality. I'll give you a brilliant example. Not my idea, but someone like Kellyanne. During debate, when he didn't want to prep for the debate, she figured out a way to have lunches, and she figured out a way to insert research and topical talking points for him. So he didn't feel the frustration of going through a debate pep sitting there at a mock podium.
But a debate is politics. It's BS.
I agree.
Geopolitical intensity.
This is even more indictment of certain people on his staff where they should have said, okay, over the weekend, we'll ride around on the golf cart with him. We'll sit with him in the study or the suite or wherever he's staying at his beautiful hotel over there, and let's talk a little bit about the issues. And by the way, you're going to be on the world stage with Vladimir Putin, who you're calling a competitor, but many people in our country view as an adversary. And so what we have to do
is... You know that, right?
He is an adversary, but let me tell you something...
He attacked our democracy. But
let me tell you something about Vladimir Putin and Russia and our history with the Russian governments for 1917. We have to figure out a way to collaborate with them. We have to.
Right, but both are true. You have to be honest about what they are, and then you find your strategic coordination.
But
you don't say they didn't attack our election. You don't say he's right and your intelligence is wrong.
He could have handled that differently, but he did walk it back. And you, I hope, are wanting to give him some credit, because let's be fair to him. Going to meet with Vladimir Putin, setting up extra meetings with Vladimir Putin are very good things for the world. If we can de-escalate the tension between the West and the Russian government, the Federation, I think that's very good for the world.
Yes,
I think you think it's very good for the world.
But here's the flaw in the argument. You're saying if we can reduce the tensions, I don't know, and speaking to experts in those arenas, they don't understand how you get a better situation out of Putin by forgiving what he does, seeming weak and seeming supple to him.
Listen, it wasn't handled well. Okay.
And now they're inviting him for a second one.
Here's the problem.
And saying that was the strategy.
But here's the problem now is that, like, there's fraidy cats inside the administration. They're not going to tell the president straight up, hey, man, it wasn't handled well. Okay. Not a big deal. We all love you. Let's get to work. Well, let's handle it better the second time. Let's commit to the following thing. You may not agree with me, but I know Jason agrees with me. President's a very good guy. He does not want war. He wants to de-escalate the situation globally. He's for peace and global prosperity. He wants to reduce tariffs, Chris. He wants to create more trade and more trade
parity. He's raising tariffs.
He's raising tariffs, but he's told everybody, the only reason why I'm raising the tariffs is your tariffs are up here. Our tariffs are down here. I'd like you to bring your tariffs down here.
No, but now they're raising their tariffs, and stuff's going to cost us more.
They're doing that, and I wrote about this in the FT last week.
Yeah,
they're doing that because they're getting hit.
I get it.
And they've got no choice because they've got people that are voting for them.
That doesn't speak well of his strategy. Look, that's not even my point. Trade is what it is. That's a political policy.
Time out a second. The instincts are great. He's doing a phenomenal job in the economy.
The instincts are not great. That's what I'm telling you. Being forgiving of Putin, not great. Calling a
free press. No, that's a tactic and a strategy. That was bad.
Well, but that's his instinct. Calling a free press, the enemy of the American people. Mao did that. Stalin did that. It was done during the French Revolution to kill off opposition. That's not what an American president says. Come on, Anthony.
Hold on a second. We could be agreeing on one thing there.
But it speaks to his instinct. What's in his head and in his heart.
That's a strategy, okay?
To attack a free press?
His instincts are peace, global prosperity, better alliances, protect the United States, put a hurt on our adversaries. But when us and our adversaries control 90% of the nuclear arsenal, let's figure out a way to get along. Let's figure out a way to de-escalate it. That'll be very good for the world. The tactics and how they went about it last weekend in Helsinki, they got to get a do-over.
How do you know they do it better?
Because I know this guy.
Dan Coats doesn't even know what was
happening. This guy didn't do his best debate was when he was under a lot of pressure.
Debate's a BS game.
Yeah.
That's jazz. That's performance.
You think so?
Yeah.
I don't know.
I grew up in it. I know it very well.
It's pretty high-stakes stuff, though, when you're running for president.
He's a great performer. But with KGB agents, it ain't a game.
Okay, and I understand that, but I like what he's doing around the world. And you got to go.
I hear you.
But he's going to denuclearize the Korean Peninsula. He's going to have a better relationship with the Russian government than the past couple of presidents. Mm-hmm. And we're going to get a trade deal done, Chris.
Right.
Hopefully you'll invite me back when we get the trade deal done.
Done.
So we can discuss that.
You're always welcome. I got a list of things I pray for also, but you got to do the actions to make them happen. Let's see what happens with the president.
Good to see you. And thank you for raising my seat on behalf of my family members.
A pleasure.
Finally,
you got this special pillow.
Finally at eye parity with you.
Special pillow just for you.
I'm intellectually way over you, but I'm at eye parity with you.
Two people believe that, you and your mom. All right, so there is something stunning about the alleged Russian spy who tried to infiltrate Washington that you may not have heard. We have news that is being neglected, and we will tell you it next. Maybe not even your mom, to be honest.
That was a very good burn. I got to give you credit for that.
I get that there's a lot of noise and we can be hyper-focused on things. I do that because I think it matters and this show's about going deep. But certain things get neglected. So I have two for you that I want you to keep on your radar. Here's number one. A Trump nominee for the all-powerful Ninth Circuit Court of Appeals abruptly derailed today, but the real story is why. It wasn't just about Democrats going after Republican choice. GOP senator sunk the nomination. His name was Ryan Bounds, just minutes before a final confirmation vote. Why? Because the White House, after Tim Scott, the lone African-American Republican senator, indicated he wouldn't back him because of concerns about racially insensitive writings from his past. Other Republicans followed suit. A blow to the president, but also insight. How can they care about the college writings of this guy, but not the writings when he was working for Ken Starr of nominee Kavanaugh? It's going to come back to them. That's why it should be on your radar. Then there's this. By now, you've heard the name. Maria Butina. She's the alleged Russian spy now indicted on conspiracy charges. Her name, apparently was not new to the White House Intelligence Committee. The ranking Democrat, Adam Schiff, tells CNN, Democrats tried to question Butina earlier this year, but he says the Republican majority shut their efforts down because they were worried about tarnishing the NRA or President Trump. Now, if that's true, that needs to be explored much further, and we are on it. If there were no other reason, the list of allegations against Butina reads like a plot from an international crime thriller. So we're going to stay on those, and so should you. Let's bring in Don Lemon, talk about what he has coming up on the show. I'm trying that. We get hyper-focused. You talked to me about this a lot when I talked about moving to the nighttime. You said, don't get too tight. Don't get too tight on what you talk about. So I'm trying to introduce some stories that we have to care about, even if we're not covering them as much right now.
There's so much that we don't talk about. I think there's so much that the audience is missing out on because of what's happening in Washington. And I should, rightfully so, maybe that's not the right way of putting it, but this is these are unprecedented times when it comes to what's happening in the White House, and especially what has happened. Chris, over the last couple of days, I heard you and Anthony Scaramucci, the Mooch, talking just moments ago. This is the second time that this president has met with a dictator and come back, and instead of saying horrible, bad things about them or putting them in their place when he's on the world stage with them, he comes back, and guess who the enemy of the people are, or the enemies, or the enemy is? And that's the fake news media, as he calls it, which is very interesting. He said, this was after the Kim summit, he said, our country's biggest enemy is the fake news so easily promulgated by fools. Well, he was played by both those people. Who's the real fool here? We're going to discuss that. Frank Booney is going to join us, as well as Carl Bernstein of Watergate fame.
You know, and look, that. And those are great guys to have on about it, because he didn't create the phrase enemy of the people. Right. The people who've used it in the past, bad guys. You don't want to be identified with them. Don Lemon, I'll be watching.
Yep. See you, sir.
All right, let's take a quick break. When I come back, I have a few final thoughts on what we were just talking about, the president's un-American new attack on the free press. Why is it un-American? Why does it matter? The closing argument next. Here's an argument. This tweet was bad for you, Mr. President. Here it is. The summit with Russia was a great success. Nobody thinks that. Except with the real enemy of the people, the fake news media. This is ugly and it is unoriginal. But most importantly, it is an admission that you hate your country. How so? Here's the case. You know this phrase was an operative threat to murder opposition in the French Revolution, right? You know Khrushchev identified the phrase as part of a campaign to annihilate individuals, literally, who disagreed with the supreme leader. His predecessor, Stalin, used it specifically with artists and thinkers that threatened his narrow views of humanity. Did you know that Mao used it during his murderous campaigns? America, the country you lead, was formed in defiance of strongmen, bullies, and the idea that might makes right. A free press is a metaphor for what makes America great. So you have now admitted that you are against what we are all about. And the real problem now is for you to convince people that you don't hate what makes America truly great. I know in the past you've tried to play that you respect the media and that you know we're important. You know, like you said that when a bunch of us got murdered. But it didn't take long to come back to this. I knew you didn't lower those flags after the Maryland newspaper shooting right away for a reason. Just like you won't really own how Russia did the U.S. dirty in the election. Why? Because you see things through the lens of what is good for you in these matters. So right now, you want people to hate us. But as the old expression goes, you point a finger at someone else, and there are three pointing back at you and a thumb that's kind of nowhere, depending on where you put it. But that's not the point. The point is, to say Putin isn't the enemy, the free press is, doesn't worry me. I know the truth. I've traveled the world, and I know our media is envied, and perhaps the best check against the abuse of power that can lead to a Stalin or a Mao. The real worry should be for you. Do you really think the people will keep a president who hates what their country is all about? That's the closing argument for us. Thank you for watching. A CNN Tonight with Don Lemon starts right now. Do you agree with my argument or no? Good. I'll take a slow clap. Appreciate
slow
it.
Slow clap. Fade to black. The end. I don't even need to go on. They can just replay.
But you will.
You. I will. But people have to remember is that the presidency comes with what? Term limits, right? Journalism does not come with term limits. We're always going to be here. So
As long as we keep our hair.
As long as...